Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the PMC for the second lecture in our series, Britain and the World in the Middle Ages, Image and Reality. My name is Lloyd De Beer. I'm a curator at the British Museum, and along with my colleague Jessica Barenbaim, I'm one of the co-conveners of this series. It's my profound honor to introduce tonight's speaker, Professor Alex Bovee, who in true Trinitarian spirit combines three jobs in one, that of Dean, Deputy Director, and Head of Research of the Courtauld Institute of Art. We are therefore extremely lucky to have pulled her away from these demanding duties to come and speak to us tonight. Alex is a medievalist and is one of the most inspiring and charismatic art historians I know. Alex is also rolling her eyes as I say this. She's worked as a curator of manuscripts at the British Library, as a lecturer at the University of Kent, before moving to the Courtauld in 2015. In a sense, this was a returning home for Alex, who worked on her PhD at the Courtauld under the supervision of John Loudon. She was, as some of you already know, the star presenter of the hit BBC series In Search of Medieval Britain, which I'm told you can still find on PBS America, which might be difficult for some here, but not at home. For those of you who follow Alex on Instagram or on Twitter, you will know that she is concerned with the interface between art history and art making. She's spent a large part of her career encouraging scholars to engage with making as a form of thinking. In 2013, she launched the revolutionary doctoral training program, Material Witness, which had students chiseling, carving, and making stained glass, and a whole host of other hands-on activities. I remember a wonderful stained glass making day at Canterbury about a decade ago. When Jessica and I were discussing who we wanted to speak as part of this series, Alex was an obvious choice, and we're obviously thrilled that she said yes, as I'm sure you are. Her research addresses many of the themes that arise over the course, that will arise over the course as a whole, but it is specifically her interest in the mythic history of Britain that brings her here tonight. And what she's going to be presenting to us tonight are three case studies that deal with mythic people, mythic animals, and mythic history. So Alex, I'll hand it over to you, and if you join me in welcoming her tonight.
Thanks, Lloyd. It's a real pleasure to be here, and now I have to figure out how to advance my slides. And it's still sort of a kind of novelty to be in a room with other people. So sorry if I get a little carried away. Right, so I'm going to start with a rather wonderful illuminated manuscript made in the middle of the 15th century, probably but not certainly in London. And the manuscript opens with a short, surprisingly interesting, treatise on heraldry, but we're going to skip over that. I'm sorry, the groans of disappointment that we're not going to dive deep into a heraldic treatise this evening. Going to jump straight to the beginning of a history known as the peculiar brute, which is to say a copy of the tremendously popular Brute Chronicle in one of its less usual, more peculiar variants. The Peculiar Brute is a long Middle English prose text written, in this copy, in a clear professional hand, which narrates the history of Britain from its foundation, notionally, as we'll find out, in about 1200 BC, all the way to the year 1419, in the middle of the reign of Henry V. The chronicle is punctuated by three miniatures, and we'll see each of them this evening, each one showing a conquest of what Jessica last week described as this Atlantic archipelago. The first of these conquests accounts for the peculiar epithet of this text, which begins in the noble land of Syria, a surprising place maybe for British history to begin, with an account of a renowned king called Diocletian, who has 33 daughters, the eldest of whom is named Albina. Diocletian invited kings, princes, lords, and ladies to a magnificent feast, whereupon he had his 33 daughters married off to 33 kings. But Albina and her sisters refused to submit to their new husbands, disobeying them at every turn. And eventually, the infuriated husbands engaged in a kind of letter-writing campaign to Diocletian, possibly demanding a return on the bill of sale or something. And Diocletian summoned his sons-in-law and his daughters to his court, where he reprimanded the 33 sisters. And in the upper part of this miniature, you can see Diocletian enthroned with the 33 princes, looking rather dull. I think you might be able to imagine why Albina and her sisters weren't happy with his matrimonial choice for them. And the sisters with their wrists crossed in a show of submission. But it turns out to be simply that, a show of submission. For that night, Albina convinced her sisters to slit the throats of their husbands. And when Diocletian discovered what they had done, he was so enraged that he put them out to sea in a ship with no rigging and no provisions, where they were cast across the seas for many long months until eventually they landed up on a totally uninhabited, verdant island that was populated only with flora and fauna, on which they feasted. And what you can see in this image is the sisters having come off their rigging-free ship, stretching, and Albina, the eldest of whom, with golden ermine robes, and her name, you can see it in the manuscript, not so easily here, that her name is inscribed on her dress. She is, I think, dusting her shoulders off, and she announces to her sisters that as the eldest, this land shall be named after herself, Albion, thus swapping an ancient name attributed to this island that had been derived from the Latin Albus for the white cliffs of Dover for something that turns out to be rather sexier. For what happens to the sisters is that they dine on the plants and animals that they find on the island, and they get what the text describes as wonder fat. And this in turn made them desire men's company more than any other solace or mirth, if you catch the text's not so subtle meaning. Sensing an opportunity, the devil materializes and visits in human form all 33 sisters, impregnating them one by one, and they then give birth to a race of demonic giants who then overrun the island. And the text names them as Gog Magog, Locarian, and others that are unnamed. And you can see at the top of the miniature a kind of foreshadowing, the sleeping giants like hills in the landscape awaiting their wicked mothers. As we shall see, this remarkable tale, which originated probably in London in the 1330s, is written really as a prequel for an older foundation myth for the British nation, which is where we'll land up at the end of this lecture. And the Albina story provides an account not just for the first humans to inhabit these islands, but the first monsters as well. It also offers an account of human history that's entangled with supernatural agents. And as a toponymic story, a naming tale, it offers a rather sexier origin for Albion than the one that we learn about from ancient texts and Julius Caesar, alluding to the chalk cliffs of the south coast. And we'll circle back to this story and this manuscript as we consider the symbolic relationship between myth and art in medieval Britain. It sounds a bit tinny, doesn't it? I'm going to put it slightly further away. How is it? Tinny? No? I'll just carry on. But it does seem a little tinny to me. Yeah? Should we carry on? We'll forge ahead. Tinny though it is. So, it is a very great pleasure to have been invited to speak on the theme of myth this evening. It's a blank slide. Yeah. It's all by design. Part of my cunning plan. It's a blank slide. Don't worry. I mean, I'll panic more than them if there are no slides. I can't speak even at the breakfast table without illustrations. So it was really a very great pleasure to have been invited by Lloyd and Jessica to speak in this series exploring Britain's place in the medieval world through art history. But as I've prepared, I found myself reflecting a little on the nature of myth and on the relationship between art history and this genre, which is really fundamentally a type of narrative, not a category of visual art. In medieval England, myth and image are very often intertwined, especially in illuminated manuscripts, which are one of the richest sources for medieval art history. And I think pretty much all of my examples this evening, if I'm not mistaken, are illuminated manuscripts, one way or the other. So I thought I might just spend a moment defining myth, what this term means and what it meant in the medieval period. And generally, it's understood by narratologists and anthropologists as a type of story with three main characteristics. It involves supernatural forces, magic, prophecies, supernatural beings of one kind or another. Myth explains the origins of something, a society, a ritual, a landscape, and it has been told over and over again. And in the retellings, through numerous variations, myth accumulates a rich set of meanings and resonances. In popular idiom, the myth also has a sense, a kind of a pejorative sense, of being something that is untrue, a misconception. You'll get cramps if you swim after eating. I don't think that's really true. It's never happened to me, and I've never observed that. You'll get warts if you touch a toad, also something that's never happened to me, although if it has to anyone else, I'm open-minded about the possibility. Tonight, though, we'll encounter mythic beings that aren't real, at least in any kind of strict zoological sense. Giants begotten by the devil and 33 evil Syrian queens. Exploding chickens are coming up. We'll be seeing goat-like, virgin-loving unicorns, and many other examples as well. Inevitably, describing a narrative as myth implies that it is not literally true. Perhaps one reason why I think we tend to shy away from describing, say, biblical narrative as myth, even though much of it satisfies the three same mythic criteria, supernatural forces, explains the origins of something, and it's been told over and over again. And I think it's telling that in Middle English, the word myth wasn't really used as a noun at all, but rather as a transitive verb, mythen, meaning to show, to reveal, to demonstrate. So in this spirit, let's consider what medieval mythic tales reveal and how they might weave together story and history, nature and the supernatural. And as Lloyd has said, what I'm going to do this evening to explore the relationship between myth and image in medieval Britain is consider three case studies interlocking, kind of messily woven together. The first focusing on mythic people, the second on mythic animals, and the third will return to the mythic history that I started with. So let's turn to mythic peoples, although actually you can see perfectly well this isn't a person, this is an exploding chicken. But it's in a manuscript that contains many examples of monstrous races, as we'll see in a second. The first of these case studies, then, is a text known as The Wonders of the East, which survives in three illuminated pre-conquest copies. The earliest of them is this one, an Old English text made around about the year 1000, in a manuscript that is celebrated mainly because it's the sole surviving witness to the Old English masterpiece, Beowulf. Most, if not all, of the texts in this manuscript are occupied with monsters one way or the other, which is something that's been greatly commented on by scholars, beginning really with J.R.R. Tolkien and in almost all of the commentaries on it since, trying to understand how it's a kind of monster compendium, this manuscript. As you can see from the scorched edges, survived really just by the skin of its teeth. It was caught up in a terrible fire at Ashburnham House in 1731 that destroyed or damaged a great proportion of Sir Robert Cotton's celebrated library. So we're very lucky indeed to have this manuscript, and it's a slightly kind of, I don't know, vertiginous feeling, thinking of how narrowly we missed out on the poem Beowulf. Fortunately, though, this text survives in a couple other copies. So The Wonders of the East is a kind of illustrated catalogue of marvelous peoples and animals that inhabited distant lands, Babylonia, Persia, Egypt, India. It has 32 kind of entries in this catalog, and it offers succinct, rather clipped, factual descriptions of each of its topics, giving the reader the essential facts about each wonder. And I'm going to begin, as you will have seen, with one of my favorites, the exploding chicken. And I think it's one of my favorites, really, because chickens are so unbelievably ordinary. And it's really only by reading the text that you discover that this one, which inhabits a place called Lentibelsinea near the Red Sea, that it is a really, truly kind of terrifying chicken. Looks very much like ordinary English chickens, red in color. But if anyone tries to grab one or touch it, they immediately burn up their body. They'll kill you. They'll incinerate you immediately. And the text says this is extraordinary magic. Immediately below is a combustible beast, a kind of theme on this page that lives in the same vicinity. And the text says, when these beasts hear a human voice, they run quickly. The beasts have 8 feet and Valkyrie eyes and 2 heads. And if anyone tries to touch them, they set their bodies aflame. These two are extraordinary beasts. And I've got a detail of these self-combusting animals. So the text takes us on a kind of tour of places that exist yet also don't exist in the land around and beyond the Red Sea. And its principal focus is on a category of wondrous peoples known as the monstrous races, which can be traced back through Pliny the Elder and into Greco-Roman traditions, even more ancient than Pliny. And one of my top favorites of the monstrous races described in the text is a character called Donestra, who lives on an island in the Red Sea. And they, the text says, have grown like soothsayers from head to the navel with a human part as well as an animal. And they know all human speech, absolutely extraordinary polyglot that can speak to anyone that encounters them. And when they see someone from a foreign country, they name him and his kinsmen with the names of acquaintances, and with lying words, they beguile him and capture him. And after that, eat him all up, except for the head. And then they sit and weep over the head. Incredibly lonely creatures, you know. So imagine knowing all languages, and you kind of want to make a friend. For some reason, you don't seem to have any. You chat away to them, and then before you know it, there you are, decapitated, head in your lap, no one to talk to again. You can see, I think, the look of, consternation or alarm on the face of his companion, who might already be missing a foot, I think. I don't know if that leg has already been detached. It also describes a character called Panotheus, who lives even further east, who's a giant, 15 feet tall, and 10 feet wide. They're rather squarish monsters. We'll see another in another of these manuscripts. They have large heads and ears like fans. They spread one beneath them at night to use as a kind of camping mattress, one ear as a mattress, and then they wrap themselves up in the other like a duvet. Their ears, the text says, are very light, and their bodies white as milk. And if they see or perceive anyone in those lands, they take their ears in their hands and go far and flee, using them, like a hang gliding sort of thing, I think. They kind of hang glide away rapidly with their ears so swiftly that one might think that they flew. So the reader of this manuscript would be able to have a kind of digest of these kind of wondrous creatures of the Far East, and then turn to Beowulf, which is very much set in the North Sea. So it includes kind of wonders of the East as well as wonders of the West. Another splendid copy of the wonders text was made maybe in Canterbury or Winchester, probably 25 or so years later than Beowulf. And it too was caught up in the cotton fire, though not nearly as badly as the Beowulf manuscript. And it presents this text in Latin and Old English. So you might say kind of three of the languages of that obtained in England at this time, images, Old English, and Latin. And it has many of the same creatures as in the Beowulf manuscript. And I'm going to show you slightly different ones, just to give a kind of broader coverage of the monstrous races that this text is concerned with. So this page includes a wild animal called a Lurtises, which has donkey's ears and sheep's wool and bird's feet. And his companion is a very celebrated creature that winds up tracking all through the Middle Ages and into Shakespeare and beyond, called a Blemma. And he gets a very short write-up, which describes him as living in on an island south of a place called Brixontes, totally undiscoverable on any known map, where there are men who have no heads but have faces in their chests. And they're 8 feet tall, and it says 8 feet wide. And this chap seems to be rather unhappy about being trapped in the space of the miniature, gazing out at us as if he wants to escape, which is precisely what he does in the coming centuries, as we'll see in a little while. Some of the entries in this wonders text explain the origins of precious materials, of spices, of jewels, and of gold. On the origin of gold, for example, we learn that it is harvested by giant ants in a country called Gorgonius. Ants, it says, are born as big as dogs, which have feet like grasshoppers and are red and black in color. The ants dig up gold from the ground from before the night to the fifth hour of the day. People who are bold enough to take the gold bring with them male camels and females with their young. They tie up the young before they and cross the river. They load the gold onto the females and mount them themselves and leave the males there. Then the ants detect the females, and I'll click over to the camel picture, the very unhappy looking camel. I think the male camel is looking rather nervous, and you'll find out why in a second. The ants detect the males, and while the ants are occupied with the males, nibbling them, as you can see, the men cross over the river with the females and the gold. They are so swift that one would think that they are flying. Kind of rather remarkable origin story, kind of satisfying, I think, if not the supernatural, well, possibly this is supernatural, then the drive that so much myth has to explain the source of something. This manuscript's 11th century readers, probably located somewhere in the south of England, may well have marveled at its accounts of unimaginably distant lands, some place names familiar from other sources, especially the Bible, but many mysterious, and indeed very difficult to pinpoint on any map, past or present. Did these readers believe that these places, people, and marvels were real? It's impossible to be certain. Such tales had been in circulation from antiquity, and so had a kind of patina of authority. In the fourth century, St. Augustine of Hippo had actually reflected quite carefully on the veracity of the legends that he'd inherited. Writing in the City of God, he asks whether we're to believe that certain monstrous races of men spoken of in secular history really existed, and if so, whether they were descended from Noah. Augustine, in his account, mentions a great many of the monstrous races that can be found in Pliny's Natural History, and then are refracted through these wonder texts. He talks about cyclops, hermaphrodites, pygmies, skiopods, and dog-headed men known as cynocephali, who are similar but less carnivorous than the Donestra. Augustine reasons that it ought not to seem absurd to us that, as in individual races, there are monstrous births, so in the whole race, there are monstrous races. Wherefore, to conclude this question cautiously and guardedly, either these things which have been told of some races have no existence at all, or if they do exist, they are not human races. But his most interesting inference is that if they do exist, and if they are human, they're descended from Adam, with a clear implication that his readers should evangelize to them, that they had souls and could be saved. So there's a kind of moral imperative for Augustine as he places them, at least possibly, within the frame of divine creation. The makers, and probably also the readers of this manuscript, would certainly have been highly educated, at least capable of reading Latin, probably Old English as well. You don't need to read both, I suppose. You just need to read one. But also bringing to the text a comprehensive understanding of the Bible and associated texts. And they would also have had access to hugely impressive libraries. The largest library in England at this time was at Canterbury Cathedral at Christchurch, and that library included copies of Augustine's City of God and also Isidore of Seville's Etymologies, which is a kind of encyclopedic work in describing all of these monstrous races and very much more as well. So they would have been able to read this text against the other works in their reference library. And this learning is refracted in the Tiberius manuscript in a number of ways, perhaps most impressive of which is an utterly remarkable world map, which you may be encountering again a little later in this series. But it's so interesting that I think it's worth coming at it from a number of different angles. This is one of the earliest surviving maps of its kind in Europe, and certainly the earliest in England, ultimately derived from a now lost Roman exemplar. And since we're considering Britain's place in the world in this series, I think it's worth taking a closer look at this source and its organization of the world. We're used to a very particular view of the world. I mean, even if you didn't happen to grow up here, I grew up on the Pacific Northwest coast. The map in my classroom, probably just like yours, had the prime meridian running straight through Greenwich. So the world is set on an axis that has London at the center. And if you're familiar with this map, then a map like this, I think, seems very strange indeed. Orientated towards the east with land masses that seem incredibly unfamiliar. But as your eye resolves, you can, I think, start to see the very impressive amount of knowledge that is puzzled into it. And I've put some of the kind of key land masses on. The European maps at this time conceived of a world with three continents, the largest of which was Asia, and most but not all maps are orientated towards the east, with Europe and Africa below. If you play, I think, quite a fun little game with this map, which is to crib a view from Google Earth and to spin it around, you start to see that the geography in this map is actually not so ignorant at all, with some very familiar shapes, Europe, Africa, and Asia, all start to resolve in quite familiar ways with major bodies of water, the Caspian Sea, the Red Sea, and the Mediterranean Sea, very literally the sea in the middle of the land, dividing Europe, Africa, and Asia. And then we have the British Isles, not right at the axis of the world, but at its very edge in the bottom left-hand corner. So that, I think, is something that should give us, I think, some sense of how British people place themselves in the world, not at the center, but at the edge. And I think also the enterprise of a map like this is rather different than, in some respects, than the kind of school map that I showed a little while ago. It's not just a map of geopolitics, it's a map of ideas, one that gives very special priority to a world centered on Jerusalem, and which is also encoded with all different types of information. Place names, certainly, but also I've pulled out a few things that we will return to. Biblical history, so it includes the spot at which Noah's ark alighted as the waters receded after the flood. It shows us where lions are, although truthfully, I'm not really sure that that's true. The lions are located just there, to the east of the Caspian Sea, although happy to be corrected about that. And it also shows where monstrous beings, Gog and Magog, we'll return to them in a little while, griffins and dog-headed people are located. So it's a really kind of remarkable, succinct piece of knowledge with all kinds of information, historical, geographical, mythical. I mentioned that a lot of the forms of knowledge in these manuscripts escapes out of the wondrous texts and out of the kind of mappa mundi that I was just looking at in the Tiberius altar and into other sources in the later Middle Ages. And I've got two examples of this from the 13th century. The first is from a really remarkable Psalter in the British Library. A Psalter is a kind of manuscript that has a central body of text, so the 150 Psalms of the Old Testament. They include other things as well, and often images. This one includes a completely mind-blowing array of wonders and monsters, including Blemmi, who's escaped from the wonders of the East, got himself a pink miniskirt and a crossbow, and is proudly kind of gazing out from underneath one of the Psalms. And you'll see, as you look at later medieval manuscripts, all kinds of monstrous races reconfigured in different ways. Panotheus, skiopods, which are described in Pliny and in the Wonders of the East, which are creatures who have one giant foot. They hop along the sub-Saharan sands of Africa until the sand gets too hot. Then they roll over onto their backs to use their giant foot as an umbrella to shield themselves from the burning midday sun. They wind up hopping all over psalters and books of hours and other texts as well. So there's a kind of rather profound afterlife where they become decoupled from the text that explains them. Whether that means that an ordinary viewer of a book like this in the 13th century would have known about the Blemmi and would have been able to understand it in relation to the Plinian story, or if it's there as a kind of provocation by the artist who's indifferent to whether you understand or not, I think is a kind of open and interesting question. Another, my sort of second example of the afterlife of these creatures is in another Psalter. This one, really small, smaller than your iPad, but larger than your iPhone. I think it's about this big, which begins with a kind of wonderful tiny map of the world, much more typical of the medieval maps of the world that you'll probably be seeing in the maps lecture later on in this series. And it places the world in a much more Christian setting, kind of obviously from the image that you have on the screen, than the Tiberius map, which includes biblical information, but lacks the kind of Christ figure who here sits atop the world, and if you didn't get the message, is also holding the world in his hand like a cricket ball with the three continents, Asia, the larger, and Europe and Africa, inscribed in a fine white line. And this this tiny map includes a huge amount of information. Jerusalem is right at the navel of the world. Eden is at the top. And it contains many, many place names from Europe, Asia, and Africa, with a stronger tilt, maybe, than we found in the Tiberius map towards biblical knowledge. This is the sort of map that you might find quite handy if you're trying to work out where things took place in the Book of Kings or similar. It also, though, has arrayed along the southern edge of the world in tiny little figures, and this is really small. These are, imagine you're holding in your hand a single piece of basmati rice. That is approximately how big these tiny little figures are. And it contains all kinds of wonders of the East arrayed along the northern edge of Africa, including Blemmi, who's again hopped out of the wonders of the East text, out of Pliny, and into this map of the world with its kind of puzzling and fascinating combination of verifiable geographical information and myth and biblical context. So we're going to now flip to think about animals as the second case study in my talk this evening, which has many similarities to the Wonders of the East text that I started with, a kind of catalog of wonders known as the bestiary. This is a genre that, like the Wonders of the East, emerges from classical sources and then, very much like the Wonders, gets recast in a kind of Christian model of the world. Its sources are an ancient Greek text known as the Physiologus, Aristotle, who wrote so much about the nature of animals, Pliny the Elder, and then these texts are kind of gathered together and recast by Isidore of Seville in his Etymologies, and then developed further in a class of manuscript that was very popular in the Middle Ages, especially in England from the 13th century. And we have some really remarkable surviving examples, ranging from rather workaday examples, and I do have one of those to show you, as well as super deluxe copies. And we're very lucky that most of the main bestiary manuscripts that I'm going to be talking about have been digitized by the Bodleian and the British Library. So if you want to see more, you'll be able to if you jot down the shelf marks in my captions, you'll be able to track down the manuscripts and leaf through them at leisure. I'm going to start with a couple of images from a manuscript known as the Aberdeen Bestiary, because it's in Aberdeen University Library, which has also been very brilliantly digitized with a full transcription and translation of all the texts. So if you want to see more of this manuscript, you'll be able to as well. And it begins with an account of the creation of the world by God, as in the book of Genesis. And here, one of a series of images, we see God creating a number of animals: elephants, a rabbit, a squirrel eating a nut, and a cat, as well as some cattle and a couple. I can't work out what all of them are because of the terrible smudge, but and a goat. So we see God creating fairly ordinary animals, or animals that I think we wouldn't want to describe as mythical in any way. And the bestiary catalogs manuscripts, get, or rather catalogs animals that fall into a number of categories, from the ordinary, like the squirrel on this page, to the exotic, like the elephant, all the way through to animals that might not exist at all, like the unicorn or the griffin. And they treat them all more or less the same, with the same degree of seriousness and this implication of that they exist and are real and need to be interpreted as part of a book of nature written by God for humans to interpret. And the bestiary gives us information, factual information, about each beast, appearance, behavior, particular characteristics, and frequently takes a kind of moral approach, explaining how their behaviors exemplify good or wicked behavior, and quite often citing biblical and patristic sources to underpin their interpretations. I've got one example from the Aberdeen Bestiary, which is a creature called the Bonacon, very kind of bull-like creature, as it says. And in fact, the text describes it thus: it has the head of a bull, and thereafter, its whole body is the size of a bull with the maned neck of a horse. Its horns are convoluted, curling back on themselves in such a way that if anyone comes up against it, he's not harmed. But the protection which its forehead denies the monster is furnished by its bowels. For when it turns to flee, it discharges fumes from the excrement of its belly over a distance of 3 acres, the heat of which sets fire to anything that it touches. Shades, I think, of the exploding chickens and the strange wolf-like creature from the Red Sea. In this way, it drives off its pursuers with its harmful excrement. So entertaining and informative, I think, in equal measure, and also unbelievably luxurious, with this shimmering gold leaf background and very kind of richly painted miniature. Not all bestiaries, in fact, most bestiaries aren't quite this glamorous, but the next one I'm going to show you is Bodley 764, also fully digitized on the Bodleian's website. We're going to look at a few examples from this manuscript, including the unicorn, which has a very extended write-up and interpretation in this manuscript, and which is accompanied, as you can see, by a rather distressing image, a virgin who's the only person who can capture a unicorn. They're incredibly ferocious and very, very fast. They're about the size of a goat. And if you want to catch one, you need to find a virgin. No easy task, sadly. Once you've got your virgin, the unicorn will come and put its head in her lap, and then the hunters can come and kill it. And the text describes the unicorn as a little beast, not unlike a young goat, and extraordinarily swift, with a horn in the middle of its brow that no hunter can catch without the assistance of the virgin, as I say. And then it segues into interpretation of the unicorn that likens it to our Lord Jesus Christ, the spiritual unicorn, of whom it is said, "My beloved is like the son of their unicorns," quoting the Song of Songs. And so the analogy that develops is that the virgin who catches the unicorn is the Virgin Mary, who catches Christ in her womb, who's then killed like Christ on the cross. And so these hunters are likened by analogy to the persecutors of Christ, and maybe with the spears would recall to the mind of the viewer Longinus piercing the side of Christ at the crucifixion. So it's not a real creature, and yet it is used to expose a kind of deeper reality in which the convinced medieval Christian would most sincerely have believed. Other creatures in this manuscript have a kind of similar, if not identical, kind of patterns of thought associated with them. So we've got the siren, which comes to the Middle Ages, I mean, really, ultimately, probably from Homer's account of Odysseus, who is warned by Circe on his way back to Ithaca to stop up his ears, lest he be tempted by the song of the sirens. Homer doesn't explain what the sirens are, whether they're birds or fish. In fact, in Homer's text, they sound more like birds than fish. And medieval artists, if you look up siren in online, there's a wonderful website, bestiary.ca, where you'll get a kind of wonderful catalog of medieval beasts. You'll see that many medieval artists hedged their bets, providing a fish's tail and also wings for these creatures, and sometimes two tails, as on the Starbucks logo. What we have in this manuscript is a warning that sailors will fall asleep to the beautiful song of the sirens, who will then attack them and rip them to pieces, completely unlike the story of Ariel, which is, I think, a kind of terrible desecration of the true, kind of dangerous story of the siren. I made sure to equip my daughters with the real story of the siren so that they could torment their friends on the playground with the, these sirens would never have given up their voices for a boyfriend, put it that way. They would have, I think, eaten the boyfriend. And that is what they're doing here. And the interpretation that the text offers is that the men are succumbing to a kind of spiritual slumber, leaving them prey to the rapacious sexual appetites of women who want to tempt them away from their monastic orders and their clerical vows and so forth. So beware, sexy songstress fish, says the text. My final example from this manuscript is probably a little self-indulgent because it involves one of my most favorite animals. I'm a great advocate of the barnacle. Not that many people have barnacles as favorite animals, I think, so I'm a kind of underdog champion with a deep love of barnacles. And part of this comes from the tale of the bestiary, which recounts how there are in Ireland a species of bird known as barnacles, which nature produces in a way which contradicts her own laws. They first appear, it says, as growths on pine logs floating on the water. They hang from seaweed on the log, their bodies protected by a shell, so that they may grow more freely. And then they hold on with their beaks. And it's this stage in their development that we see in this image. In due course, they grow a covering of strong feathers and either fall from the water or change to free flight in the air. And interestingly, this is a sort of unusual intrusion of an authorial voice into this text. It says, I have seen them myself with my own eyes many times, thousands of these small bird-like bodies hanging from just one log on the seashore in their shells and already formed. And it then goes on to describe how, because they're flesh that comes from neither land nor sea, monks can eat them on Fridays or when they're fasting. A rather wonderful delicacy, as you may have surmised. The stalked barnacle or the goose barnacle, which the bestiary interprets, following on from Isidore and Gerald of Wales and other writers who consider that the barnacle goose is the adult form of the goose barnacle. And so far as I'm aware, no one has been able to verify whether or not this is the case, but the bestiary certainly gives it as a solemn fact. The last of the bestiary examples that I'm going to look at comes from the Westminster Bestiary, which very unfortunately hasn't been digitized at all. But I do have this rather magnificent example of a passage from this manuscript that relates to the monstrous races. It kind of recasts Isidore of Seville's text and illustrates it with a giant, a three-faced giant, a tiny pygmy, a skiapod, whom I mentioned earlier, and four monstrous races known as Bragmanii. And just to demonstrate that not all medieval bestiaries are super deluxe and glamorous and filled with gold, here's a rather scruffier one, which is another example of a third, so-called third family bestiary that includes this, this text. These manuscripts reflect more than 1,000 years of lore about animals and the people of the world and establish their authority in a variety of ways. They cite the Bible, ancient authorities, and eyewitness accounts. Ordinary, familiar creatures, goats, ants, crows, give credibility to the exotic but not unknown, lions, elephants, and also to the fabulous, griffins, unicorns, basilisks. The images add a further layer of credibility. Illustrations underpin the text, showing as well as telling. But their ultimate purpose is not to provide a truthful zoology or anthropology, rather than to fill the reader and viewer with wonder and to offer them a way of thinking about nature and a set of moral examples to follow. So with these examples in mind, we'll turn to my third and final kind of case study of mythic art in medieval England. And this takes many of the mythic modes that we've been considering and deploys them as history. In the 1130s, the cleric Geoffrey of Monmouth set himself the task of writing a history of the kings of England. He explains at the start of his text that he intended his work to be a prequel to the works of Gildas the Wise and the Venerable Bede, who'd written nothing, Geoffrey complains, of the kings who lived here before Christ's incarnation. Strategically vague about his sources, Geoffrey claimed that his history was a translation of a very old book in the British tongue given to him by a certain Walter, Archdeacon of Oxford. Notionally beginning around 1200 BC, Geoffrey's history opens with the conquest of Britain by a band of Trojan refugees and continues through the era of King Arthur up to the 7th century AD, inventing King Lear along the way. Elaborating on earlier sources, including the 9th century Historia Britonum attributed to Nennius, Geoffrey relates how Aeneas and other survivors of the Trojan War fled to Italy and founded a kingdom there. Aeneas' son Ascantius founded and ruled Albus, which passed to his son Silvius, the father of Brutus. Fulfilling a prophecy, Brutus kills his father in a hunting accident and is exiled to Greece, and there he discovers the descendants of King Priam enslaved to the Greek king Pandrasus. Promising to liberate them, Brutus became the leader of those who survived the fall of Troy, and together they escaped. And Geoffrey seems quite aware of the kind of Trojan legends and very able to kind of remix and graft a new story onto them. He explains how the goddess Diana offered Brutus prophetic advice about where the displaced Trojans should go, advising them to go to the west, to the kingdoms beyond Gaul, where there lies in an island of the ocean surrounded by the sea, a place where giants once lived, but which is now deserted and waiting for your people. So Brutus and his group battled their way westward. Geoffrey gives us lots of detail about their adventures. Eventually, loaded with treasure, plundered from the Gauls, they sailed to the island of Albion, making landfall in the region of Totnes. And here is one of the very many examples of Geoffrey's text with his claim that there are no inhabitants on the island but for a few giants. Diana, it turns out, was mistaken in that one not insignificant fact. And here we have a map from the end of the 14th century called the Goth map, which also has a kind of easterly orientation. It makes the island look rather sock-like, I think. I think you can tell that the people who made this map didn't know that much about Scotland, but had a fairly secure understanding of Wales and England. And it's a little hard to read now without assistance, but inside the red box is a rich set of details of place names and also a little inscription that explains where Brutus landed with the Trojans, in the area around Totnes. So they alighted at Totnes. Brutus names the island Brutane after himself and his people, Britons, and they discover Diana's error. The island is completely overrun with giants, and they exterminate them all, but for the last of the giants called Gog Magog. And Geoffrey describes how Brutus preserves Gog Magog so that his best friend Coronaeus, who's an inveterate wrestler of giants, can have a battle with the monster, which he describes in kind of arresting detail. And we'll move to the second image, returning to the peculiar brute that we started with, to its second image of conquest, which is the kind of climax of the wrestling match between Coronaeus, future Duke of Cornwall, and the monster. And Geoffrey describes how they come to the top of a cliff and begin to wrestle. The giant has the upper hand at first and cracks three of Coronaeus's ribs. And this so enrages the Trojan that he heaves the giant up onto his shoulders and runs to the cliff, throws him over the edge, and then the giant's body is broken on the rocks below, staining forever the rocky shore with its blood. And returning to the peculiar brute image gives us, I think, a really fascinating interpretation of this text. You might notice that the ships are very different than the one that Albina and her sisters arrived on, fully rigged with furled sails and a crowd of armed Trojans. Coronaeus, I spent quite a lot of time trying to figure out, I feel rather foolish about this, trying to figure out what the heraldry was on his tunic, and all was explained when I happened to notice the arms of Cornwall on some Duchy Originals oatcakes. So he's very on message. I'm surprised, in fact, that the Prince of Wales hasn't used this image to sell his delicious baked goods. And so we have this account of the monster as well that we'll return to shortly. After the giants are finally exterminated, Gog Magog, the last of this indigenous species, Brutus then makes his way to a spot in the Thames estuary and founds a city known as the New Troy, later known as London, which is close to where we are now. We're outside the walls of London. This is a fantastic manuscript, perhaps somewhat less neatly painted than the Laud manuscript that we've been looking at, which narrates this story in the upper portion with the arrival of the Trojans and the very well-dressed giants in wonderful hats and mini dresses. They exterminate them, and then we have Brutus and his stonemasons beginning to construct the glittering city of London. And as you will have picked up, I think, from the different images that we've been looking at, Geoffrey's story was an absolutely extraordinary success, circulating in Latin, French, and English versions, and translated very quickly after its composition into Anglo-Norman French. And I'm showing you here a diagram that we won't discuss in any detail, simply to kind of indicate the many different versions of this story that circulated all the deep into the age of print. It was first printed by Caxton in 1480, and there are all kinds of fascinating crossings over between Latin, French, and English, and between manuscript and print. The Brute text that I've been discussing in relation to the Laud manuscript with its Albina legend is one of the most popular Middle English texts that survives of all, in more than 250 manuscript witnesses. So it's a runaway success, this text. And a sign of its success is that it gets the episode of the foundation of Britain gets extracted from Geoffrey's historical narrative and inserted into other people's. For example, Matthew Paris's Chronica Maiora, which was composed and illustrated by this wonderful kind of artist monk chronicler at St. Albans, includes his predecessor, Richard of Wendover, insert the Brutus legend into a recounting of the Book of Judges, kind of giving this story the same billing as a biblical narrative. And what we have here is Brutus and his men sacrificing to the goddess Diana, who has the most wonderful kind of winged anklets, and their kind of sacrificed animal at her feet. So it gets stitched into other historical narratives as well. Matthew also includes Brutus as the first in his gallery of kings of Britain. And here he also gives us a wonderful detail at the feet of Brutus, the kind of gurning, monstrous giants at his feet, defeated by the first king. The story of the defeat of the giant sometimes, too, gets incorporated in other kinds of historical chronicle. This is the very beginning of a long genealogical roll of the kings of England. Normally, these genealogical rolls begin with the Anglo-Saxon Heptarchy, but this one, rather unusually, starts with the Trojans on horseback defeating the gurning helmeted giants right at the start. So it's a kind of establisher for the entirety of British history. And here we are back at Laud 733 with Diocletian and Albina and the start of this story. So Geoffrey's Brutus legend was really cast as the inciting incident for all of British history. Yet it left readers wondering, where had the giants come from? And by the 14th century, this story of Albina that we've already discussed and her sisters had emerged. Also by the mid-15th century, Albina's conquest prefigured Brutus's in many versions of the Brute Chronicle, in which Geoffrey's mythic history is intertwined with a rather more conventional historical narrative. Thus, the third and final conquest pictured in the Laud manuscript is the Norman conquest of 1066. This Gelfriedan legend has been dovetailed, very neatly jointed onto a narrative history that is rather more verifiable. Geoffrey himself wasn't interested in recent history, and the conquest does not feature at all in his narrative. Yet, it was certainly an important part of the Anglo-Norman context in which he was writing. His preoccupation with the ancient origins and longevity of Britain perhaps underscores to his readers, whose parents and grandparents would have included Norman settlers, the deeper history to which they were connected. And it perhaps helps to explain the incredible popularity and durability of Geoffrey's Brutus myth. And if this gives us some insights into the context in which Geoffrey was writing, I think we should finish up by focusing on how Geoffrey availed himself of the mythic sources that were all around him to populate the Brutus story. By tying Britain's history to Troy, he gave the nation a foundation coeval with Rome's, in fact, maybe even slightly earlier, and established a powerful myth of London as the new Troy, which is a recurrent myth coming back, for example, after the Great Fire of London, and most recently, to my knowledge, after the worst night of the Blitz, when newspaper headlines described London razed to the ground as once again the new Troy to rise again from the ashes. So it's a very persistent conception of London. By populating Albion with a race of indigenous giants, Geoffrey made conquerors of the Trojans rather than comparatively less heroic settlers that they would have been had they not had to defeat the giants. And by populating Albion with giants, Geoffrey associated the Trojan conquest with a tradition that identified giants with the primeval. In Genesis, before the flood, giants populated the earth, and although seemingly exterminated in the flood, giants reappear here and there throughout the Old Testament. Og of Bashan in the Book of Numbers, David's Philistine opponent in the Book of Kings, for example. Naming the giant Gog Magog was also a knowing move, fusing together the apocalyptic bogeyman mentioned in Ezekiel and Revelation, and evoking too the well-known legend that Alexander the Great had imprisoned Gog and Magog behind a mighty wall. Medieval cartographers, like the ones that we've the one that we've encountered already, located Gog and Magog on an island in Asia near the Urals, and we've seen here that they live very nearby the griffins as well in this monstrous landscape to the east of the Caspian. Another wonderful, sadly lost mapamundi known as the Ebstorf map, destroyed in 1943, an absolutely enormous, the largest known mapamundi, also includes a wonderful detail of Gog Magog intramuraled near the Caspian, cannibal-like, devouring the limbs of struggling victims nearby. It's kind of useful to note that in the V&A's gallery, medieval gallery, they've included a very large reproduction of this map. So if you want to see it, that's probably the best chance of seeing it. So it's, I think, probably about two-thirds of the size that it originally was. But here we have, anyway, Gog and Magog again. And they get refracted, too, in the Legends of Alexander, which were very popular all around Europe and beyond in the Middle Ages. And so here we have a rather scruffy but wonderful example of Thomas of Kent's Romance of Alexander from the mid-13th century, which gives us Gog and Magog like wild men, hairy and consuming, chomping on body parts in a way that might remind you of Donestra waving his victim's leg around in the Beowulf manuscript, and again in the hairy form of Gog Magog, might recall the wild man character of Corineus's enemy in the Laud manuscript. And the Laud artist, I think, interestingly, does seem aware of this tradition and to want to remix it a little himself with the wild man, or with the giant's hairy coat, in marked contrast to Corineus's heraldic tunic that I've already mentioned. The tales and images that I've shared this evening all fit, I think, with the definition of myth that I offered at the start. Supernatural forces, explanatory motivation, frequent retelling. And I think they also show how, in the Middle Ages, myth could be a transitive verb to show, to reveal, to demonstrate. If not a literal truth, then perhaps a deeper one, something like Picasso's quip that art is a lie that makes us realize the truth. I'm going to end by observing that myth can, in the end, become real after a fashion. Over the centuries, Geoffrey's giants have taken on a life of their own. Gog Magog and Coronaeus became, by the 15th century, emblems of the city of London, made into pageant figures to welcome monarchs and honor mayors on their inauguration days. And in fact, many of the post-medieval legends about giants that circulated in early modern and modern England were myths concocted to explain the curiosity of the pageant figures that had been set up in the Guildhall to the bemusement of many generations of Londoners. And even now, every year, Geoffrey's giants walk the streets of London as part of the Lord Mayor's Show, here shown with their makers and also National Treasure Giles Brandreth, to the bemusement and consternation, I think, of many generations of Londoners. So, in considering these myths, we are, I think, inevitably participating in them in some quite interesting ways. From noun to transitive verb, walking with Geoffrey through the streets of London. And I'm gonna end there with an extremely long clip of Cash from the BBC in 2016. So thank you.
Good. Thank you. That was absolutely wonderful. That was really brilliant. And
you it's know. Still going on.
Oh, my gosh, still going. I'm sorry. Am I upstaging a national treasure? Should I?
I think we just need to go back to the still of Giles with the basket weavers. I think.
I mean, just to emphasize what a brilliant, you know, piece of work Alex has done. This is such a vast hinterland of complex, overwhelming, and critical material, so to be able to synthesize and kind of bring out these sort of really central important themes in that way is just amazingly impressive. So thank you so much. So I'm going to be moderating questions, and I'm also going to shamelessly ask the first question. So I ponder questions you may have. We'll be taking questions from here and also from people at home. But I just wanted to start, I suppose, by asking in a sense, a question about one of what's I guess took to be a central kind of theme or backbone of your talk. So one of the points that you sort of highlighted throughout is the way in which certain kind of images from these narratives of myths become, I think you use the, I mean, I love the way you talk about escape and the way you show that visually, but also become decoupled, and you find them in the pageant figures, you find them in other stories, you find them in other, in all kinds of places. And you particularly talked about the giants and the way in which the giants sort of do that. And I guess I wondered, in a sense, what brought you to the giants and why that image, you know, seemed to take on such a life of its own. What is the appeal of the idea and the image of a country that was populated by giants?
Well, that's a complicated question. Mm. Okay, so what brought me to it was my students, in fact. I used to teach a special subject called the monster in medieval art. And I tried to jack it up with the most exciting monsters that I could think of. I excluded exploding chickens. Chickens aren't interesting. I also thought giants were fairly boring. I mean, all the giants are is very large people. And at one year, at kind of midterm, I think I sent around a questionnaire to the students saying, what would you drop and what would you add? You know, what should we have an extra seminar on? And there was huge support. There was a groundswell of support for giants. And I started teaching a seminar on the brute legends. And I think the ordinariness of that form of monstrosity gave way to, I think, an understanding of just how ubiquitous and therefore interesting giants are. And, are these giants? Why have they become such a kind of lasting symbol of nationhood? I think there's no simple answer to that. I think part of it is that they're a very, Geoffrey's conception of them tapping into biblical legend and then also bouncing off the Alexander legends meant that they were highly remixable and familiar yet unfamiliar in ways that made them very elastic over time. But I think the other thing about them, though, is they have a kind of feeling of a folktale. that something that is a kind of, you know, an earth, like a springs up from the groundwater of a kind of population. But every example that we have of the giants, it pulls in the other direction, towards an elite. Geoffrey was an extraordinarily learned Latinate cleric, and he's writing for an erudite clerical audience. And even now, when they as they walk through the streets of London now, it's the Lord Mayor and the livery companies of the City of London that encourage it. So,
this is really fascinating because it's sort of like an academic's idea of a folktale.
Yeah.
You know. And also, you know, what you're saying about how, oh, at first you thought of giants, well, they're just like people but bigger. You know, it's like the blemmii.
Yeah.
But of course, that makes them a bit uncanny because they're sort of like people, but not exactly like people, and representing them in such a way that they seem strange is kind of a challenge to an artist. Oh, wonderful. Anyway, okay. I think I've monopolized the questions long enough. Okay. So should we start with one from the room, maybe, and then we can take one from home. Then have a question in the room. We could also, I mean, we could go to one at home if there's one from home as well. Yeah, okay, I think there's one from home.
I got a lot of questions coming in from home, actually. It's quite hard to choose from between them. But one question from Tim Node, which is our first question, Alex, was, did anyone publicly question the more far-fetched mythical stories at the time? Would they have been accused of heresy if they'd done so?
So medieval skepticism is a really fascinating topic, and there are lots of examples of people questioning the inherited wisdom that they received. There are famous examples of people questioning whether, even holy relics were authentic. And certainly, I think people wondered, as St. Augustine of Hippo did, whether the monstrous races were real. I don't know that heresy, I think questioning the dogmas of the church, I think, would have been heretical, but wondering whether a griffin was a real animal, probably not so much. It is, I think, telling, though, that cathedral treasuries included unicorn horns and griffin claws. So I think there probably was a kind of reasonably secure appreciation that they might have existed or probably existed. And probably also a sense that one might have, I don't know, about Santa Claus even, of sort of taking pleasure in the potential truth or untruth of a received legend. So yeah, but there are, and I mean, after the Middle Ages, as people worked their way through the foundation myths of Britain, there are lots of examples of early modern historians really trying to demonstrate their historical nous by distinguishing the verifiable from the not verifiable. And you'll be shocked to discover that many early modern historians thought that Geoffrey of Monmouth had made it up.
Which, wonder where on earth they got that idea.
But of course, he'd actually discovered it all from an ancient book in a British language that only he could read, that Walter the Deacon had given him.
Thank you, Alex. I was going to just pick up on that because I remember, I think, in our time on Gerald of Wales, where Melvyn Bragg was absolutely committed to trying to say that Gerald was somehow an idiot for buying into these, like he was stupid. Gerald of Wales, if anyone doesn't know, he's a writer in the 13th century. He wanted to be Archbishop of Canterbury, but he became, I don't think he was ever Bishop of St. David's, but anyway, he was a very learned man. He made these important journeys to Wales, to England obviously, but also to Ireland. And my question kind of comes around to the point of the senses in both relation to image and reality. So you talked about how, I think in one of the texts it talks about, I've seen them myself with my very own eyes. And Gerald does that too, where he'll be describing something completely ridiculous to us, and then he says, but I've seen this with my very own eyes. So the relationship both between sight, physical sight, and then the representation of an image and our perception of it through sight to the reality behind the image and the act itself, and it not being in a state of stupidity. I think you were just talking about these things both interacting at the same time,
yeah,
pleasurably in a way.
Well, I think someone like Gerald of Wales, who I didn't really talk about this evening, except for in relation to the barnacles. In fact, I think the passage in that bestiary, either it's quoting Gerald or Gerald is quoting the bestiary in his claim to have seen things with his own eyes. Although he has a kind of ethnographic sensibility as he describes, I don't know, fish with golden teeth and surprisingly attractive bearded women who were very good with textiles as he kind of goes around describing the kind of marvels of the West. He's very much in that genre. I think historians, and I'm quite content to describe Geoffrey and Gerald and other writers of this kind as historians of the Middle Ages, I think often present modern historiographers with a real challenge because it was a world in which the miraculous was completely accepted, you know, where a historically verifiable account of a bishop saint, say, you know, might have, you know, dates in which he was enthroned as Archbishop of Canterbury, but then also explain how, you know, he would throw demons out of wolverines using a prayer or stay a falling beam with a mark of the cross. There's a world in which extraordinary things, I think, were accepted. And I suppose what I would say about that, too, is that extraordinary things do happen. I mean, the world is full of marvels. Mm-hmm. And if one chooses to disregard that or treat everything like in a sort of jaded way as a commonplace, then I think it's a world denuded of some of its wonder and mystery, and we're the losers, I suppose. So I don't know, but I do think that playfulness also accounts for things. I think someone like Gerald is playing with his reader and tempting them to think of familiar places or nearby places as just as wonderful as the Eastern world described by Pliny and his successors, you know? How rude of Melvin, though.
Alex, I've got two related questions coming from home. From an anonymous attendee has asked, why do you think giants or defeat of giants is such a recurring element in myths, especially myths that have been used to define groups, for instance, nations and religions? And a second question, which could almost answer the first, I guess, was it's been asked by Joseph Rosenblum, who asked, does the conquest of giants signify victory of civilization over demonic nature?
Well, I think the answer to this second question is yes. I think that is the function that they perform in these stories. I think why do giants have this significance is a much more kind of profound and unanswerable question of the kind that, I don't know, Claude Lévi-Strauss or Joseph Conrad might grapple with. I think a kind of simple answer, if an incomplete one, is that a lot of medieval mythographers take their cues from the Book of Genesis and the idea that there's an antediluvian world that is populated with sinful creatures. The giants of Genesis, another set of texts explained, known as the Book of Enoch, are meant to be the offspring of giants, of men and angels, who are completely sinful, and one of the inciting incidents for the divine flood described in the Book of Genesis. But I mean, that only goes so far. I mean, you know, that only takes you to the, you know, it's clearly very, very persuasive, pervasive all around the world and in the midst of many nations, that there was a giant time before. And maybe kind of looping back to what I was saying in answer to Lloyd's question, to me it's fascinating, and I have nothing more than a kind of observation about this. It's fascinating to me that in fact there was a time, I mean, it's just simply the case that there was a time of giant flora and fauna before the huge meteorite just wiped out the dinosaurs. There was a time with, you know, and in fact, you know, many megafaunal animals survive well into the modern era. I mean, the last auroch, the kind of great, mighty, almost mythical bull, lived, there's one actually, there's a skull of an auroch on display right now in the wonderful Stonehenge exhibition at the British Museum. They became extinct in the 17th century. You know, there are such wonders could and in fact did exist. And one, I think, plausible explanation for many of the myths about a time of giants is that people found bones. They found the bones of dinosaurs and other kind of megafaunal remains. I mean, you know, people find today all the time the giant Irish elk. I mean, you know, absolutely titanic creatures. And so I think if you find something like that, or, you know, you have a cathedral treasury that has enormous, inexplicably large femurs in it, and we know that they did, you might observe, well, these giant creatures don't exist anymore, so, but they clearly once did, and therefore think that there is some literal truth to some of the inherited myths and legends and Genesis stories. But I can't really go much further than that, but to observe that, you know, there were one, I mean, well, the largest creature ever to live is still alive, I suppose, in the form of the blue whale, but, you know, all the other ones are gone.
Yeah. I mean, what do you make of the, I'm just thinking in terms of the first kind of discussion that you began with about Albania and the Balian manuscript. Mm. So, what do you make of the fact that both the Trojans and the giants, to some extent, come from elsewhere? Mm. It's sort of two waves, actually. So the giants don't spring up from the soil, or in a sense, in some ways they do, but the fact that their mothers, you know, are also from away. You know, what role does that play? I mean, I'm not even thinking in general, I'm thinking in that manuscript, you know, just the miniature that you began with.
So I think, well, it's very difficult to just isolate that one manuscript from the entire narrative tradition, because it is innovative and in many ways. I mean, one of the things in that manuscript that is, I think, a little striking is it is quite interested, as you observe, in mothers. I mean, it puts amongst the Trojans females who were distinctly absent in Geoffrey's text. Yeah. I think, you know, in Geoffrey's text, you'd think that there was some kind of parthenogenesis happening, you know, once the Britons had settled down, where would they get girlfriends? And then the devil would have to rematerialize all over again. So I think some of the thinking, I think, is just common sense in understanding that people migrate and have migrated. It's interesting, though, I think, that one of the problems that you identify, Bede also touches on in his history of the English people. Everyone, including us, I think, is slightly puzzled about the great age of migration in the 4th, 5th century AD, where you know, and even earlier, thinking about another wonderful British Museum exhibition from a few years ago now about the Celts, where I think people did find it mysterious where people had come from, and they observed similarities in language and culture, in decorative motifs from, you know, the Rhine Valley and England and so forth. So I think that part of the explanatory power of the story is trying to explain things that people were puzzled by, and that even, you know, as I say, Bede was puzzled by. Yeah. Where had everybody come from in this kind of great age of migration? But I think it's also the kind of, you know, once upon a time problem. I mean, it probably also, I think, takes an important cue from back to the book of Genesis, which begins at the very beginning with the creation of all things and the peopling of the world. And I think some of this storytelling is intended to, I guess, answer questions provoked by authoritative texts of those kinds. And I think interesting in the context of a lecture series about art is what the function of images is in all of this. You know, is this just, are these kind of narrative traditions that are primarily to do with spoken and textual language, or do images play an important part in reinforcing, explaining, provoking, you know, trying to show people as well as just tell them?
Well, actually, what you made me think of is in the migration of ideas from one arena to another. So there's the migration of people, but those images that sort of escape. Sorry, I was so overwhelmed with excitement when you're talking. I forgot the microphone. Allow ideas to migrate from one realm to another. Sorry, there were more questions. Well, is there another question in the room before I go to the people at home? Yes, good. Sorry.
Hallucinogenic influences. Fairly obvious, deeply obvious, carriers of wisdom, carriers of personal experience, must be significant in what we've seen tonight. Have you any view on that?
No, I don't really. I mean, I have to admit, I don't know that much about medieval ancient hallucinations.
Although I'm open to trying them, I suppose, if anybody's got some. I think it's entirely possible to come up with an extraordinary tale stone cold sober. And in fact, you're probably more likely to. I think we've all had an experience one time or another where an inebriated or intoxicated person attempts to tell an entertaining story and it's entertaining only to them, right? You know, we've all been there. So it may be. I mean, I think you can make hallucinogens out of grains and alcohol and all, there's an element of ritual drinking in a lot of the tale telling that underpins these stories. I mean, I mentioned the Beowulf manuscript. It has, you know, lengthy sections of drunken boasting in the hall, and so I think the idea that there's a kind of a context for storytelling that involves drink and merriment and conviviality and people coming together is certainly the case. But I don't know that you need hallucinogens to come up with stories like this. I mean, maybe. Do you? I mean, does anyone else think so? I mean, why not? People are always trying to intoxicate themselves one way or the other. I suppose shortly that will be the case for many of us. But I don't want to rule it out, but I don't necessarily know that it's a necessary precondition for a wondrous tale. Put it that way. Yeah.
Do we have time for one more from home or? We have time for one more.
This is a nice short, sharp question. Maybe, from Rosemary Clark. She asks, how is it that Gogmagog is one person sometimes and two at others?
Well, that's a short question, but a long answer. I think, so I wonder if Rosemary is noticing that in the pageant giants that the basket makers constructed in 2006 or whenever it was, the identities of the giants had slipped apart. So the shortest possible answer is that in the 15th century, people started to put up two giants on the gates of London, normally on the southern side of London Bridge for royal entries, and then sometimes also for royal exits at Temple Bar. And there's always two, almost always seems to be two of them. So who were they? I think from quite an early date, from the reign of Mary I, they're identified as Gog Magog and Coronaeus. And it's interesting to me that somehow these arch enemies, one of whom murdered the other, get revived and turned into companions, and articulate companions who, instead of being enemies of one another and of the people of Britain, become spokesgiants for the corporation of the City of London. But then they get, after the pageants take place, the figures get set up in Guildhall, and that, I think, is where confusion starts to arise. People constantly forget who the giants were, and think that they're Hercules and Samson. They think that they're Goliath sometimes. I mean, there's lots of kind of forgetting of this story. And then in remembering it, the story gets retold. So someone will say, no. It's not these things. It's not Hercules. It's Gog Magog and Coronaeus. And then they kind of pull back together again. But it's really fascinating to me that when the basket makers company went to this extraordinary effort of weaving these wicker giants, they too, like so many of their predecessors, had slipped back into a biblical understanding rather than a Galfridan one. And I think one of my theories about this is that in a narrative tradition, forgetting is just as important as remembering. And that quite often, the things that survive are the provocation for a new tale or a new twist on a tale. And it's like that kind of swerve away from an authoritative text. And that's part of the kind of richness, I think, of myth generally, is retelling different versions, little twists, elaborations, solving problems that are left. But I'm quite happy. I think it's quite interesting and kind of endearing that they made these, in fact, because there had been this terrible kind of huge balloon that was the two giants, but they were like conjoint twins that were dragged through the streets of London, and the basket makers, I think, just really disapproved of them being a latex balloon. And so, yeah.
All right. Well, so we've returned to this image, actually. Perfect. Yeah. So the only thing left is for me to thank Alex so much. Really, thank you so much for coming to
Jessica.
Give this
lecture. Thank you,
Jessica. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you to everybody at home.
Thank you.